We're here at Stanford Medical School with fourth-year medical student Morgan Theis and Dr. Charles Prober.
Okay, Dr. Prober, what are we going to talk about today?
So, Morgan, I thought we'd talk about bacterial meningitis in children.
Okay.
And what I'd like to do in reflecting on bacterial meningitis is go back to some lessons that we learned in the prudent prescribing of antibiotics, a former video or prior video.
Okay.
And one of the things that was mentioned as a general principle in that particular video was trying to understand where the site of infection is in a child in order to pick the right antibiotics and the right management.
Okay.
So in this case, because I'm referring to bacterial meningitis, the question might be, what would make you think that a child has bacterial meningitis? That is, what are the signs and symptoms of bacterial meningitis?
So this is kind of thinking about the site, knowing that there's an infection in the cerebrospinal fluid or fluid around the brain and spinal cord. You have to look for that in a variety of ways as a doctor.
Exactly. And one of the things which will make a physician suspicious that there may be an infection in the cerebral spinal fluid or that is in the central nervous system is a child may not be behaving normally. That is, mm-hmm. they'll have an altered state of consciousness. They'll be very, very sleepy, or they'll be very irritable.
Okay. So I would say the signs here, irritable children. And what was the other one you said?
And I mentioned they might be very sleepy. Some people might use the word lethargic as a altered state of consciousness.
Okay.
And at the extreme of that, the child would be in coma, but that would be more advanced in the infection.
Okay.
And then the child would almost invariably have a fever associated with it, with this illness. And on examination, when the physician examines the child, they may detect what are called meningeal signs. And those meningeal signs include a stiff neck, especially if the child's over 1 or 2 years of age.
And how can you tell if someone has a stiff neck?
So what the physician will often do is hold the child behind the head and try to flex the head on the neck, try to flex the neck, and stiff would be literally that the child's neck would not bend when the head is elevated from the bed.
Oh, wow, so it just stays really, linear, you can't really curve it well.
Exactly.
Okay.
The other meningeal signs that may be present in addition to the stiff neck are the child may have some seizures, abnormal movements.
Okay.
The child might also assume an abnormal posture, a stiffening of the body. So not just the neck being stiff, but the rest of the body being stiff as well. And on examination of the neurologic system, the nervous system, the child may have what are referred to as focal signs, that is, asymmetry between the two sides of the body.
Oh, and what kinds of things would you see that were asymmetrical?
It could be that one side of the body is weaker than the other. Mm. It could be that one side of the body has different reflexes than the other side of the body. So these are all signs and symptoms that may be associated with bacterial meningitis that would make the physician suspicious of the diagnosis of meningitis.
Okay, so we talked about some of the things you look for as a doctor. Now, just going back a minute, you said we're talking about bacterial meningitis. Does that assume that there's other types of meningitis that we're not addressing in this lecture?
That's a very important point. So I am focusing on bacterial meningitis. There are other types of organisms, that is non-bacteria, that can cause meningitis, and the most prominent of those other organisms are viruses. So you can have a viral meningitis, sometimes referred to as aseptic meningitis, and that in fact is more common than bacterial meningitis. So it's very important to consider.
Okay.
There are also some parasites that can cause meningitis, and there's some fungi that can cause meningitis. The fungi and parasites are uncommon in the general population, but they may occur in patients who have an abnormal immune system.
Okay.
Viral meningitis, on the other hand, is really, as I mentioned, quite common.
Okay.
But for today, I'm focusing on bacterial meningitis. So you suspect that the infection may be present based upon those signs and symptoms that we've spoken about. And then to prove or determine whether or not meningitis is present, a cerebrospinal fluid examination or cerebrospinal fluid has to be examined. And cerebrospinal fluid, which is typically abbreviated CSF,
stands for cerebrospinal fluid. We already got that, but okay. Sorry.
And that's obtained by doing something called a lumbar puncture, by putting a needle in the back to obtain fluid.
Okay. Is that also what a spinal tap is?
And that's also called a spinal tap, exactly. Okay. A lumbar puncture or spinal tap. When that's obtained, using a needle into the lumbar area, the fluid is then sent to the laboratory, who will examine the fluid in different ways.
Okay.
One is to look under the microscope and determine if there are an abnormal number of white blood cells present.
So abnormal meaning high or low?
Meaning just high, actually.
Okay.
The normal number of white blood cells in the CSF is zero, so high is something greater than zero.
Okay.
And with bacterial meningitis, it tends to be really quite high, 1 or 2,000 or more than that.
Okay.
With viral meningitis, it may not be quite as high.
And that's per some unit of volume of this fluid. Okay.
Exactly. A glucose concentration is also measured when the fluid is sent to the lab. And with bacterial meningitis, the glucose in the spinal fluid tends to be low, less than 40.
Now, why would it be low?
It's low because with meningitis, you have an abnormal penetrability or lack of penetrability of the meninges, which are the coverings of the brain, reducing the amount of glucose that's transported into the spinal fluid.
Okay.
And then most importantly, the fluid is examined with something called a Gram stain, a special kind of stain. It's Gram with a capital G, named after Dr. Gram. And the Gram stain can determine whether or not there are bacteria present.
Okay, so you're actually staining the bacteria.
Exactly. And if there are sufficient bacteria present, the Gram stain will reveal those bacteria.
Okay.
And so with bacterial meningitis, there are, the second principle, prudent principle, is to know the usual pathogen. So if a spinal fluid is obtained, there are lots of white cells, the glucose is low, even with a negative Gram stain, one can guess the usual pathogens because the list is short in normal children. And those bacteria, the short list includes a bacteria called Haemophilus influenza, type B. A second bacteria...
Is there an A on that? An E at the end?
There is an E on the end. A second bacteria is the pneumococcus.
Well, that's funny. It sounds like it causes pneumonia. But...
And it does indeed cause pneumonia as well, but it also causes bacterial meningitis.
Okay.
And a third bacteria is called meningococcus. And those are the prominent bacteria in normal children with bacterial meningitis. The reason, though, we're not seeing as much bacterial meningitis in 2011 as we were seeing 10 and 20 years ago is we now have vaccination against each of those three different pathogens.
All of them?
We do. We vaccinate against Haemophilus influenza type B starting at 2 months of age. And by the time the child is about a year and a half, they're completely protected against that particular bacteria.
Okay.
The pneumococcus we also vaccinate against, and it's very successful. The vaccine is very successful at reducing the frequency of pneumococcal meningitis. It also starts at 2 months of age.
Okay.
And meningococcus is, the vaccine is relatively new and is used in children who are a bit older. They're over 2 years of age under special circumstances. So that means that we still can see and do see cases of meningococcal meningitis because it occurs in children under 2 years of age.
I see.
But those are the usual pathogens. And when you go to other parts of the world who don't use vaccines, those are the pathogens that will be prominent in causing bacterial meningitis. And knowing those pathogens, we go to the third principle of antibiotic prescribing, which is knowing what antibiotics typically kill those bacteria.
Okay, so what should I call that category?
And that's called
matching.
The pathogen sensitivity, knowing what antibiotics work against the likely bug. So pathogen sensitivity.
Okay,
right.
Great.
Sensitivity to the antibiotics.
And that I think you were mentioning in your last lecture, that varies by the location in the body and the location in the world that you're using the antibiotic. Is that right?
It varies according to the location in the world.
But not in the body.
Not in what part of the body they're in.
Oh, okay.
And fortunately, for the treatment of bacterial meningitis, to cover all three of the bacteria that are on the list of pathogens, two antibiotics cover all three of them. And I'll just mention their names and as I end this. One antibiotic is cefotaxime. And a reasonable facsimile of cefotaxime is ceftriaxone. They're very similar antibiotics. So we give one or the other of those two antibiotics.
And okay. And
because some of the pneumococci are resistant to so-called beta-lactam drugs, penicillin and cephalosporins, vancomycin also is used to initiate therapy for suspected bacterial meningitis.
Okay, so we use vancomycin if we think you have sort of resistant bugs that are resistant to the first two antibiotics you mentioned.
Exactly.
And there's some kind of lab test you might be able to do to find that out.
Exactly. So those are the principles of antibiotic prescribing in terms of the diagnosis of bacterial meningitis, knowing the site of infection, that is the spinal fluid, knowing how to diagnose it, what the pathogens are, and what antibiotics would work against those pathogens at that site of infection.
Okay, and just my last question is, just because we've learned a lot about how there is a tight barrier between the blood and the cerebrospinal fluid, are these antibiotics that you've listed here, are those able to sort of penetrate through that barrier and get into the cerebrospinal fluid?
An extraordinarily important question, which got to another principle of antibiotics, which is you have to make sure that they can be delivered to the suspected site of infection, and for those particular antibiotics, the answer is yes.
Okay, thank you so much.